Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us today on the webinar hosted by myself, Dr. Ricardo del Castillo. Today we have Dr. Ramon Aragon. Dr. Ramon Aragon is a UAG grad. He's currently a board certified adult psychiatry physician. I believe he also did a fellowship in consultation liaison psychiatry, and he's currently practicing in Austin, Texas. Dr. Aragon, thank you for joining us, and please take it away.
Hey, good afternoon, evening, everyone. Thank you for having me. Again, I'm Dr. Aragon. I am a board certified psychiatrist, and I'm going to be talking to you guys about Alzheimer's disease today. Very important topic. I'm sure everyone has seen, read, or met someone, unfortunately, that has suffered the disease. So let's look a little bit how we're going to be talking about this today. We're going to walk through a little bit of the history, just very briefly. Talk about the epidemiology, which will highlight the importance of this disorder. Talk a little bit about the cognitive features and non-cognitive clinical features that will help us identify the disease in our patients, as well as the etiology. Talk a bit of a pathophysiology, diagnosis, and very importantly, well, treatment, right? We're diagnosing Alzheimer's disease with the purpose of trying to improve our patients' lives. So how we're going to treat it. If we have a little bit of time, I will throw in a couple of clinical vignettes just to highlight some of the ways the topic that we just discussed may be asked of you in future exams. All right, I have no pertinent financial affiliations, which I wish we could all disclose these on meetings, but there's nothing for me to disclose. A bit about the history. So this gentleman right here, renowned German psychiatrist by the name of Alois Alzheimer. He is the one, of course, credited with the discovery of Alzheimer's disease, worked with Emil Kraepelin, who is another German psychiatrist. For those of you guys who are not familiar with this name, if you're interested in psychiatry or real about psychiatrist history, this will definitely come into play. Kraepelin is hailed as the father of modern scientific psychiatry. And they got to work together during the 1900s. Well, Dr. Alzheimer worked with a patient by the name of Augusta de Terre. She was a 51-year-old female who started exhibiting cognitive deficits as well as some behavioral disturbances. And when she died, he had an opportunity to do some brain histopathology, and he identified the plaques and tangles that are characteristic of Alzheimer's disease. Kraepelin was able to replicate those findings in other patients with similar presentation. So he supported that these findings together were named after his colleague, Alzheimer. This is a photo of Ms. de Terre. You can see fortunately fragile, frail, vulnerable old lady, but she was 51 years old. So you can see the deterioration in her physical state here. Now, why is Alzheimer's disease so important? This is why we talk about the epidemiology. Alzheimer's disease is the most common cause of dementia, and it is the sixth most common cause of death in the United States. When we talk about dementia, we are talking about an umbrella term that describes the loss of cognitive abilities. Talking about the incidence and prevalence, it tends to increase with age, as you would probably expect. The incidence also increases with age. 400 out of 100,000 individuals that lie between the ages of 65 and 74 years of age. You can see how it reaches almost 8,000 out of 100,000 when we get older than 85 years of age. The prevalence, it's an estimated 6 million individuals in the United States suffering from Alzheimer's disease, living with Alzheimer's disease. And the age distribution is very similar to that of the incidence. However, the vast majority of folks will lie between 75 and 84 years of age, and that is just because of life expectancy and mortality. A gender distribution, Alzheimer's disease is more commonly found in females than it is in males. And early onset Alzheimer's, which is usually found before the age of 65, tends to just comprise about 10% of all the Alzheimer's disease cases. Now, what are the clinical features of Alzheimer's disease? This include cognitive clinical findings, most commonly short-term memory impairment. There is a subtype that you will classify as mild cognitive impairment. And this is cognitive impairment that does not really interfere with the activities of daily living. Well, when we get to the diagnosis part, we'll describe what these activities of daily living may be. And essentially, bathing, being able to cook, manage finances, all the things that you go about on a daily basis. It has a slow progression, and the episodic memory tends to be affected first, with procedural memory tending to be affected towards the latter parts of the disorder. Language impairment is mostly characterized by word finding difficulties. Temporal and spatial disorientations, these patients unfortunately get to the point that they are not oriented to person, place, time, situation, or events. And there are impairments in executive functions and judgment. Now, this is when it gets dangerous when you talk about an individual with advanced or progressing Alzheimer's disease that may be driving out in the city or using dangerous equipment or machinery. Something as simple as a drill, for instance. Non-cognitive features of Alzheimer's disease include neuropsychiatric signs and symptoms. As a psychiatrist, I can tell you these are some of the things that bring the patients through my door more frequently. But it can include apathy, agitation, irritability, and aggression, which tends to be the reason why relatives will bring the patients to the doctor's office. Anxiety, mutism, hallucinations and paranoia, which can be very distressing, not only to the patients, but also to the relatives. Other physical and medical findings, urinary incontinence, hyposmia, myoclonus, and seizures. And as you can probably tell, these fours and features are likely related to the area of the brain that is going through advanced atrophy. And what are the risk factors that can predispose someone to develop Alzheimer's disease? Age is perhaps the strongest predisposing factor for the development of Alzheimer's disease. A family history of dementia, especially for early onset Alzheimer's disease, low socioeconomic status, diabetes, obesity, hypertension. African Americans or Hispanic descent tend to have a higher risk when compared to the white cohort. Lack of physical activity, TBIs, and environmental factors. You see these risk factors, there are similarities, of course, with cardiovascular disease. And cardiovascular disease, of course, is a risk factor for cognitive deficits or decline. Now, what causes Alzheimer's disease? Reality is, we don't really know. But we have a few theories that have been proven helpful, especially in the treatment domain. In people with early onset Alzheimer's disease, this is folks that are between their 30s and 60s, a genetic mutation may be the cause. We'll talk a little about which genes are involved. Regarding late onset Alzheimer's disease, for folks that are older than 65 years of age, complex series of brain changes, both macro and microvascular changes, essentially it is a multifactorial disease. It means generic environmental and lifestyle factors will increase the chances of someone presenting with Alzheimer's disease. And we mentioned genes are important. It's part of the etiology. And this is perhaps a high yield slide for those of you guys preparing some of your steps or those who are about to enter clinical practice. This is something that is good because it'll help us understand what causes it. Regarding genes, the amyloid precursor protein gene, located in chromosome 21, it encodes for APP. And this is linked to about 10 to 15% of the early onset Alzheimer's disease cases. And since it's encoded in chromosome 21, patients with trisomy 21 or Down syndrome have a higher risk of developing early onset Alzheimer's disease as they have an extra copy of this gene. Presenilin 1, located on chromosome 14, presenilin 2 and chromosome 1, both of these encode for different subunits of gamma secretase. And we'll talk about the importance of gamma secretase in a little bit, but they're linked to approximately 50% of familial Alzheimer's disease cases. APOE, located in chromosome 19, encodes for apolipoprotein E, and it increases the risk of late onset Alzheimer's disease with the number of APOE4 alleles. It means if you inherit two copies from your parents, your risk is going to be a lot higher than if you just inherit one. And conversely, if you inherit APOE2 alleles, that actually has a protective effect. And the same rule applies. If you inherit two of them, your likelihood of developing Alzheimer's disease is going to be a little bit less. talking about the pathophysiology. These are the pathophysiological mechanisms that we know contribute to developing Alzheimer's disease. We've probably all heard it. Senile plaques, neuritic plaques, which are essentially referring to beta amyloid plaques. These plaques or accumulations are extracellular in nature, which means they're located outside of the neuron cell body, usually found in the gray matter of the brain. And the main component of this is amyloid beta protein. All right. Now, this explains how beta amyloid plaques are made. So we have APP with an extracellular portion, intracellular transmembranous section. You have two pathways this can go through. The regular non-pathological, non-amyloidogenic pathway right here on the top, where alpha secretase will come and cleave the protein right on the extracellular portion. This is a soluble protein, so it'll be detached. Gamma secretase will come and cleave the transmembranous portion, and this will just separate into soluble portions that will not disrupt intracellular neuronal function. However, in our folks with Alzheimer's disease, this amyloidogenic pathway, beta secretase will miss its mark. It will cleave it where alpha secretase did not. So it will create this soluble subportion and leave this transmembranous portion to be a little larger. Gamma secretase will come and cleave, and it will create this beta amyloid oligomer, which is prone to aggregate. When several of these are available, they will start clumping up and create these amyloid plaques that lie in between neuron bodies. Now, since they're in between these neuronal channels, it will disrupt neurotransmitter function, interneuron communication, and it's also hypothesized that this actually triggers an inflammatory response that leads to local tissue disruption. Why we said it was important to consider presenilin 1 and 2, they're subunits of gamma secretase. So you see, gamma secretase is actually involved in both the non-amyloidogenic and amyloidogenic pathway. So if these are improperly encoded, it can lead to gamma secretase actually cleaving at different portions that will create insoluble residues that will disrupt intracellular function. Just perhaps a shorter version of what I just spent the last couple of minutes talking about. Now, neurofibrillary tangles. These are probably things that are jogging your memory, talking about testable material. Now, neurofibrillary tangles are intracellular. You'll find them within the neuronal cell body. The tangles are composed of hyperphosphorylated tau protein. So you can consider this a tauopathy. This is usually caused because of hyperphosphorylation of the tau, and I will show you a very elaborate diagram of how this happens. Another way Alzheimer's disease can occur is through reduced cholinergic function. It is hypothesized that acetylcholine deficiency related to the degeneration of cholinergic neurons will disrupt the memory functions of the brain. And these three mechanisms are potential targets for treatment and research at this time. The other neurotransmitter systems are generally less affected, of course, with cerebrocortical atrophy, some networks may be affected. This is a very elaborate diagram that I produced for you guys. Now, just imagine we're inside the neuron. We're inside the cell, and you see these microtubules. As you know, microtubules serve to move things around within the cell, sort of like railroads, per se. These little green dots represent tau protein. When phosphokinase joins a party, it's going to hyperphosphorylate these tau proteins, which their function is to stabilize the microtubules, keep them functioning properly. When they become phosphorylated, they will stop doing their work. They will stop stabilizing the microtubules, which means the internal communication network for the neuron is no longer functioning, and then they're going to come entangled. They will remain within the cell, but they can become visible now. Microscopically, amyloid beta plaques stained with Congo red, and they can cause cerebral amyloid angiopathy. I'll show you a diagram in a little bit. What this means is the amyloid plaques will attach to the blood vessels' walls, and they will weaken the walls. When that happens, it can create microbleeds that will in turn create inflammation in the surrounding area and tissue destruction in the brain. Tau protein stains with gallia silver, and here are antibodies that you usually don't get tested or seen, but they're also aggregates of intracellular residues. You can see here the beta amyloid plaques extracellular, see the cell bodies around them. You can see how this can disrupt the communication and how big they can get. Amyloid angiopathy, we're talking about before. You can see the amyloid stained with Congo red surrounding the blood vessel. Now, you don't really see it here, perhaps because of the stain, but you really pay close attention here. You can see how the barrier gets disrupted and the wall becomes frail. Neurofibrillary tangles, intracellular, this is how they would look like. Macroscopically, we probably know already and conceptualize that Alzheimer's disease leads to cerebral atrophy. This can be seen in two different ways. You can pull someone's brains out, and which is probably not going to be able to do someone that's alive, but you can do that with imaging studies. You can use MRI, CT, and the things that we usually use is our MRIs, and we ask the radiologist to look for hippocampal slices, or 1 millimeter slices for the hippocampus, and you can see the damage to those areas. With more sophisticated imaging versions, such as DWI, you can see axonal degeneration, neuronal loss, you can see all those neuronal tracts being disrupted. You can look for degeneration of cholinergic neurons in the nucleus of Meynert. And of course, if you look at the broad picture, you can see the diffuse cortical atrophy, which tends to be the most common description in someone that has an MRI. They will either describe that there is more widespread atrophy than that expected for their age, or they will just describe it as normal or expected for the age. So that may be an indicator for something for someone that has ordered a brain MRI for a different reason, perhaps. Here's some photos of macroscopic changes. You can see figure A, normal brain. You can see all the gyri pretty deep, only together, all the sulci. See a pretty well packed, plump brain. In contrasting with figure C, where you can see all the atrophy, how deep the sulcuses are, the sulci are, the gyri, they're not as slink and plump. On the sagittal center section, you see the size of the ventricles for a normal brain. Really no discernible atrophy here. Of course, this person probably had something more than just Alzheimer's disease, but you can see the hippocampal atrophy in the enlargement of the ventricles, which will be important when we talk about imaging studies. Here, MRI imaging for amyloid angiopathy. You can see all these black spots. Those are where the blood vessels and the amyloid deposits are. Different versions of MRI with SWI. On this side, ventricles filled with CSF. How do we diagnose it? As a psychiatrist, I resort to what's probably called my Bible, DSM-5, which talks about major neurocognitive disorder. Is a more proper way of describing dementias. And you classify which type of dementias, and we'll talk a little bit about the other versions in a little bit. But you have to prove that there's evidence of significant cognitive decline from whatever the previous level of performance was. And these are the cognitive domains that we look for. Learning and memory, language, executive function, complex attention, perceptual motor, social cognition. And I'll show you a few examples of how we test for that. These cognitive deficits have to interfere with everyday activities. So the activities of daily living we were just referring to a little bit ago. Or they should need some assistance with instrumental activities of daily living, paying bills, managing medications. As you can tell, these things are things that could probably jeopardize someone's quality of life. These deficits should not occur in the context of delirium or exclusively in the context of delirium, as these two are not mutually exclusive. And of course, they're not better explained by something else. You'll find this criterion on basically any DSM diagnosis. It shouldn't be explained by something else. You can do neuropsychological testing. These are highly specialized tests that will look at all these domains. Oh, excuse me, my mouse is very sensitive. All these domains, very in depth. Now, they are very expensive tests and very time consuming. You get a lot of information, but a test, the neuropsychological test, can take up to 4 hours. And you Talking about someone that may be displaying advanced cognitive deficits, you can imagine how this can be pretty complicated and complex. Cognitive testing. This is perhaps it is our bread and butter in psychiatry and neurology. And it's things that if you've already done your clinical rotations, you might have already been tasked with doing so. You might recognize the mini mental status examination, the Fohlstein, the MoCA. MiniCOG is one of my favorites. It's pretty quick. You can do it in like 3 minutes. And you get a good idea of how the patient's cognitive function is. Good thing is you get a score that you can track over time to see if this patient has shown some decline or improvement with your treatments. Functional testing, global testing, and caregiver-based testing, especially for folks that cannot participate. Dr. Casillo, can you hear me?
Yes,
okay,
I think you cut out for a little bit. Now we can hear you.
Okay, but I'm back, right?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. I think I got a phone call on my phone and it cut out my audio. I apologize for that. Sometimes our patients cannot participate in these examinations, and this is when you do the caregiver-based testing. You're using a reliable collateral source to complete these diagnostic tests. This may be familiar for some of you guys. There were some versions of this out in the news with a very prominent political individual in the past. Montreal Cognitive Assessment, or the MoCA. You can see all the domains that are being tested here. My personal favorite, so if I can have someone complete the full test and I can get them to do just one thing, I will pick the clock. The clock will encompass all of these visual, spatial, memory, recollection, and just a very simple test. Test naming, memory, attention, language, abstraction, delay, recall, and orientation. As you can probably imagine, these actually tests a pretty comprehensive test, and it touches upon different areas of the brain. This gives you an idea of all the different localization in the brain that the MoCA is assessing. Clock drawing test, here more in the temporal region, however, also involves some abstraction, attention, executive function to be able to draw it, and short-term memory, because you have to remember the instructions, of course. Here's a comparison, just in case you want to see more or less what areas were being tested and what their anatomical correlate may be. Mini mental status exam, equally short, both of them are 30 points. This one is perhaps a little faster. MoCA takes about 10 minutes to complete. Mini mental status examination takes roughly about 5 minutes. One of the problems with the MMSE is that it is biased against folks that don't have at least an elementary high school education. If you have someone that is essentially illiterate, they will miss a lot of these points on account of their academic status, not necessarily their cognitive status. So it's important to consider that when you're doing this examination and you don't fully believe that a patient is as efficient as you might find in these tests. Scoring, these two tests are essentially screening tools. You get about a 5-point break. If you miss 5 points, you're still gonna be like within the questionably significant. You may have not paid attention, didn't have a good breakfast, things of that sort that can be significant in an elderly patient. So you want to get a baseline and repeat these things over time. There are places that will do daily MMSEs. Value of that, it remains to be determined, but at least on every visit in an outpatient setting, or at least weekly in an inpatient setting, will have some value for your monitoring. Diagnostic tools and procedures. Neurologists will sometimes obtain EEGs to rule out seizures, and they will find some slower basic rhythm. Not specific, sensitivity may be low, but it's a commonly found finding. Neuroimaging, CT, MRI, as I discussed a little bit ago, you can see the signs of generalized or focal atrophy. The enlarged ventricles, narrowing the gyri, the prominent cerebral sulci, you can see hydrocephalus as ex vacuo. So we'll
contrast that, for instance, with normal pressure hydrocephalus, because you will see the ventricles expand, but you will not have that wet, wacky, and wobbly triad that you would see in NPH. PET scans are becoming more and more commonly used, and I presume soon they will become part of the standard of care. You can actually, using a FDG PET, you can actually look at the temporal parietal metabolism, which you can expect it to be decreased in Alzheimer's disease. With an amyloid PET scan, you can see the amyloid signal being increased, which will suggest amyloid plaque deposition in someone's brain. If you do a lumbar puncture and study for CSF, you can expect to see an increase in the phosphorylated tau protein, and interestingly, a decrease in the beta amyloid proteins. This is because it's accumulated in the brain. It's not being seeped into the cerebrospinal fluid. What are the stages of Alzheimer's disease? Now that you already know like what it looks like, how to diagnose it, where will you put it? Mild Alzheimer's disease. This is where you will most likely catch someone exhibiting some cognitive deficits. This is where people themselves start noticing some difficulties and families will start noticing it. So greater memory loss, some other cognitive difficulties, they start wandering and getting lost occasionally. They start having problems handling money, paying bills. They repeat questions after you just answer them. They take longer to complete whatever normal tasks they used to not have any problems with. And I know as I'm going through these stages, and please don't try to diagnose your parents or your grandparents. This is something that I'll tell you, but it's something, but you may start remembering someone that you know that maybe started exhibiting some of these things. And it's not necessarily a bad thing, but don't go and tell them that you have Alzheimer's disease. Moderate Alzheimer's disease, of course, the damage is becoming a little more extensive. You start having more problems with the areas that control language, reasoning, conscious thought. Hyposmia becomes more of a, of course, with COVID, that may change a little bit, but hyposmia becomes more of a sign that you can see among these patients. They have a harder time learning new things and do multi-step instructions. Hallucinations, delusions, and paranoia become more prominent in this stage. And this is, again, very scary to families and relatives. So this is where this elderly patient starts thinking that people are breaking into their house, stealing their things. They're seeing people walk in and out of their room or walking around their homes. And that can lead to aggression, and they would try to defend themselves because they feel very scared. That's where the paranoia comes in. Now, severe Alzheimer's disease, we're getting close to the end of life. The plaques and tangles are just spread out, way too widespread. They cannot communicate anymore any of their needs, and essentially start shutting down. Now, how do people with Alzheimer's die? Infection tends to be the most common reason, and it's usually from pneumonia, and aspiration pneumonia is perhaps one of the most common causes of death in our patients with Alzheimer's disease. Now, we said dementia is an umbrella term for different types of cognitive impairments. This is a very extensive list of differentials, but you have to include normal aging. People with normal aging, when they're getting to the later age, they will start exhibiting some cognitive problems. It's normal to forget some things. It doesn't necessarily mean you have Alzheimer's disease. Pseudodementia, found in mood disorders, mostly with major depression, of course, Alzheimer's disease. Vascular dementia, that you will see with microvascular changes in the brain. Bigger insults like intracranial hemorrhages, such as strokes or aneurysm ruptures, dementia with Lewy bodies. In our folks that are exhibiting behavioral changes, frontotemporal dementia becomes an important differential to consider. Normal pressure hydrocephalus, as I mentioned before, this one is potentially reversible, whereas the ventricular changes in Alzheimer's may be misleading, but they are not reversible. Parkinson's disease, and someone that has a history of alcohol use, Wernicke encephalopathy and Wernicke Korsakoff syndrome. Late neurosyphilis used to not be as common anymore. However, over the last decade, there's been an uptick in syphilis cases, and at least identified syphilis cases. So it may be something that you see in the future. So it's important to consider the other signs of neurosyphilis. Wilson's disease, Kaiser-Fleiser rings, high yield topic. You'll definitely be tested on that on your SMLE. PML, Creutzfeldt-Jakob, and Huntington's disease. Also, you're going to be tested. Those CAC repeats, you will see dementia in these patients. However, you also see the chorea. And the psychosis will be a lot more prominent than that in Alzheimer's disease. Now you know how to diagnose it. Now you know how to identify it, but how do we treat it, right? That's what we went to medical school for. We try to understand these things so we can make our patients' lives a little better. Memory training. Nowadays, you can see download apps. There's like tons of games. Our patients' families are very well versed in this because they try it. So that stimulates memory and it can help improve, especially for the milder versions of it. You want to include that in your treatment. Now, as far as medicines, cholinesterase inhibitors are the first line treatment, especially in your mild to moderate stages. They may be beneficial in other forms of dementias, but their impact is not as robust as it may be in Alzheimer's and vascular dementia. And that is because of the pathophysiology we discussed. There is disruption of cholinergic systems in both. Of course, vascular dementia, we're talking about direct insult to those networks. And in Alzheimer's disease, plaque deposition can disrupt and inflammation can disrupt that cholinergic conduction. Medications, donepezil, rivastigmine, galantamine, definitely going to be tested on these things. How do they work? They just inhibit cholinesterase. So there's more acetylcholine available for neuronal transmission, which is crucial for memory function. Adverse side effects, and this is no mild feature, nausea, dizziness, insomnia. The nausea may be a very prominent limiting factor for your patients to be able to tolerate donepezil. So we have a rule in geriatric psychiatry and geriatric medicine in general. You start low and go slow. And although you may be eager to try and treat them and getting better to preserve those memory functions, you don't want to be overly enthusiastic with these meds. You want to give the patient time to adapt and to tolerate. Contraindications, cardiac conditions, especially conduction abnormalities. These medications do prolong QT, and they're usually the patients are on other medications that can prolong QT, as we'll talk about in a second. Memantine, brand name Namenda, because now it's available in generic, but you will hear that name thrown out there a lot of times because it's used in several other disorders. Now, the recommendation is mostly for our patients that have advanced cases of Alzheimer's disease, but we also use it in folks with milder versions that were unable to tolerate your cholinesterase inhibitors. It is an NMDA receptor antagonism, and the way it's theorized that it works is that it prevents glutamate-induced calcium excitotoxicity, so it becomes kind of neuroprotective in a way. Adverse side effects, headaches and dizziness, confusion, hallucinations, seizures, not as commonly seen. The headaches and dizziness perhaps is the most commonly reported side effect. Now, the new kid on the block, if you guys kept up with the news this last year, you probably saw that there was a new breakthrough treatment for Alzheimer's disease, Ducanumab or Aduhelm, MAB at the end, that indicates monoclonal antibody immune therapy. And it is the only disease modifying medication that is currently approved to treat Alzheimer's disease. And it received an accelerated FDA approval. Now, that's perhaps a topic to discuss in a different setting, but it was actually a breakthrough drug. And it is designed to target and remove beta amyloid. Now, that's a very important thing because it doesn't stop the body or the brain from producing beta amyloid plaques. What this does is just comes and cleans it up. And if you reduce the beta amyloid load, you're theorizing that you're gonna preserve the neuronal function and brain function a little bit better, perhaps for a little bit longer. Now, that's the theory behind it. It was studied in early Alzheimer's disease, so we don't really know how it will work for folks that have already been affected on moderate or late stages of Alzheimer's disease. The cost was initially about $50,000 per year. It is a weekly infusion, so it is very time-consuming and resource-consuming, but the cost was eventually dropped to about like $20,000 to $25,000 for the first year. It is covered by Medicare. Everyone was very freaked out when it was covered because that was going to lead to a very significant increase in Medicare rates. And of course, Medicare comes from taxpayer dollars, so no one wanted to just throw the money at it if we didn't know if it was going to work. So they modified the approval. Now it's just approved for folks that are enrolling clinical trials that are in the early stages of Alzheimer's. We don't have any long-term studies to really determine if the removal of amyloid plaques or the amyloid load is going to result in long-term improvement, but we'll just, like I said there, we're just going to have to wait and see. But it is good. I mean, in a field that you get to see just many patients just wither away, talking about something that can bring hope to families and also providers, because I can tell you this is very heartbreaking to be treating day in, day out. So thinking there is a possibility, or they will be in the next few years, it's actually pretty encouraging. Our patients can become agitated, and your relatives will bring them to your office to tell you that they've been really aggressive, really angry. What would you do? We use antidepressants. Citalopram has been the most widely studied in dementia. Citalopram is one of the most serotonergic antidepressants we have. It can prolong QT, which is why it's also important to look at all the medications, do very good medication reconciliation, to look at the ones that can impact cardiac conduction. Feeding difficulties, as I said, leading cause of death, pneumonia, aspiration pneumonia, very high contributor. So it says it may require replacement of a G-tube. And I guess an important note to make here, a lot of patients will not want to have their parents with a G-tube, but they say, why not an NG-tube? First, very uncomfortable. If the patient is confused, you can imagine them just pulling it, right? So we're back to square one. And also, NG-tubes do not prevent aspiration. Not that G-tubes do, but the time that the food will be in the stomach will be much less than it will be with an NG-tube. Sleep disorders in general, and this is not just for patients with Alzheimer's disease, but for everyone, non-pharmacological treatments are preferred. Environmental restructuring, general sleep hygiene, medication reconciliation to make sure you don't have a medication that's activating, that's being given at the wrong time of the day, that's causing the patient to not be able to sleep. If you have to use pharmacotherapy, we try to use melatonin or trazodone. However, very low doses. Melatonin, it is not a hypnotic. It's hailed mostly as a chronotropic, which means it protects and fosters circadian rhythm stability. So low doses of melatonin tend to be a little more chronotropic than higher doses. And melatonin, probably everyone knows, go to CVS, Walgreens, or your neighborhood pharmacy and pick it up. It'll be in 5-10 milligrams, and people will be taking one or two or more of those. It's really not worth the risk of side effects with that. Pain. You don't want to be using opioids in these patients unless it's absolutely necessary. A multimodal pain management will be much better preferred, and it will have better effects than just using a medication that can increase fall risks or lead to constipation, which can precipitate other problems, of course, like an intestinal obstruction. Agitation, psychosis, like I said, very distressing for patients and families. Atypical antipsychotics, that's your second generation antipsychotics, have a black box warning for increased mortality when used in patients with dementia, not just Alzheimer's disease dementia. Historically, people will prefer low dose first generation. However, because it may help with sleep and other features such as depression, we do use atypical antipsychotics, but it is very important that we have a very lengthy and thorough discussion with the patient. Of course, informed consent is important, but also with the families. You want to know that they understand the risks of taking a medication. Non-pharmacological measures. This is where you get to start talking to even your parents, if that's the case, but definitely your patients and their caregivers. Avoid sudden changes in the patient routine or environment. I cannot tell you how many times I've had a patient be totally decompensated and the family thought that it was a good idea to take him out on a vacation without prior notice or preparation. They just decided to take him out to a hotel. And of course, the patient wandered from the hotel and they had to call the cops. And although it sounds like a weird anecdote, I can tell it has happened more than 5 times. Not to the same hotel or city though. Physical exercise, as much as the patient can tolerate. Aerobic exercise is very recommended. Music therapy and animal assisted therapy can be beneficial, but you have to be very careful with fall risk. If there are pets in the house, you do not want your elderly patients tripping, falling, hitting their heads. This is very important to discuss, and with a caveat. We don't really know how the Duhelm is going to change the course of illness. So for the sake of this discussion, we'll forget about the Duhelm just for this graph. Historically, a normal individual will be this green line. Your cognitive function in relationship to time will decline. As I said, there's a normal decline in cognitive abilities. You will go through some cortical atrophy and you'll die sometime around here. Without treatment, you'll start exhibiting cognitive decline in several domains and time will progress and you'll end up here. But of course, it's an exaggeration, but you get the idea that your cognitive abilities will decline to this point. If you treat it with cholinesterase inhibitors or memantine, the goal is preserving the memory functions as much as we can to improve the quality of life. However, you will not change the endpoint when you treat it. And that is something very important to discuss with family members. Once we've established a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease, is that we're gonna treat it. We're gonna be aggressive with it while being very cautious, but also we're gonna know that what we're trying to do is preserve that quality of life as much as we can. But eventually we'll need to have a discussion about adding a caregiver, changing the setting, removing dangerous items, because this will happen. We still have a few minutes, so let me just throw this clinical vignette. I'm going to put things together with what we just discussed. 70-year-old man brought to the physician by his daughter due to increasing forgetfulness over the last 3 years. Initially, he used to forget the grandchildren's names and forget to lock the house door. During the past year, he has gotten lost while trying to come back from the grocery store and was unable to state his address. On one occasion, he went to the park with granddaughter and returned home alone. He just left her there. He forgot that he had her with her. His granddaughter says that over the last year, he has withdrawn himself from social gatherings and avoids making conversation. He doesn't sleep well at night. The daughter has hired a helper to cook and clean his home. And on your examination, mental status examination, he is oriented only to person. He describes his mood as fair, short and long memory deficits are present, and he a person different about his memory lapses. He says it's normal for someone his age. The most appropriate initial pharmacotherapy for this patient is a drug that acts on which of the following neurotransmitters? We have GABA, serotonin, acetylcholine, norepinephrine, dopamine. And of course, the answer is acetylcholine. We described its cause, in part at least, by a degeneration of the cholinergic neurons. It is important to mention that there are other theories that involve dysfunctional GABA systems, serotonin dysfunction in different areas of the brain, especially for executive functioning and impulse control, norepinephrine with anxiety and distress, dopamine with the psychosis. However, the most accepted neurotransmitter dysfunction for Alzheimer's disease in this case would be acetylcholine. I want to mention something about this clinical vignette. It talks about the progression of someone with Alzheimer's disease, especially this part where he is not really bothered by his memory lapses, and he says it's normal. There is a very important feature that I didn't mention before in the clinical assessment, but it's called confabulation. So when patients are asked about something, like, what did you have for breakfast? Oh, I had pancakes, and they were delicious, and I had this, and I had that. And you ask the reliable source of information, they're like, no, they had eggs, I cooked the eggs. I'm sure they had eggs. There were no pancakes in the house. And the patient will make this story about why the answer was wrong. Oh no, I was thinking about this other day. And it's very common. They won't really be bothered. When people start becoming bothered by memory lapses is in the early stages, the mild cognitive impairment stage. When they start noticing that balancing their checkbook is not as easy as it was before, when they're having a harder time remembering their shopping list, where they know that they're starting to forget the people that they work with, what their names are, or people that they used to see every day. Another clinical vignette, a 73-year-old man brought to the physician by his daughter for evaluation of increasing forgetfulness during the past 6 months. The daughter reports that he recently got lost while walking home from the grocery store. He's also been more irritable recently. On mental status examination, he has a normal affect, oriented to person and place, but cannot recall what month it is. He recalls memories from more than 20 years ago in great detail, but cannot state his home address or the name of his recently born grandson. His gait is normal, and there is no nystagmus. An MRI of the brain is shown. Which of the following is the most likely underlying cause of radiologic findings? Is it atrophy of the cortex, demyelination of the periventricular structure, bleeding into the ventricular system, obstruction of the foramen of Monroe? Of course, atrophy of the cortex. This is what we're talking about when I mentioned hydrocephalus ex vacuo. It means you're producing and reabsorbing CSF all day, right? But as the cortex becomes atrophied, there's more space for the fluid to occupy. So this pushes against the cerebral parenchyma and it enlarges the ventricle. Now, as the vignette explains, there is no change in gait, so NPH will be less likely. There, the way that the image highlights, you could think about a demyelinating process such as multiple sclerosis, but there are, there are no other symptoms that would suggest a demyelinating process. As we near the end of our webinar for this lecture, I want you guys to remember something. I was told you're all in different stages of your training. I heard this when I was in medical school, probably around my second year. And as I became a psychiatrist, I don't think it resonates more with me than it is when I treat patients with Alzheimer's disease or other types of dementia. So as doctors, we try to cure sometimes, we aim to relieve often, but we must always aim to comfort our patients. We cannot cure Alzheimer's disease, can't do that now. I don't know if we'll be able to do it in the next few years. I sure hope so, because you know, it's 6 million people, at least in the United States, living with that. Imagine if we could cure all of them, how many lives we could change, but we can't. It is very taxing on families. It is very taxing on the patients. So being there as a guide and support, regardless of your specialty of choice, will impact your patient's life. You can make a difference just by remembering this. Your job is not only to prescribe, but also to comfort and educate. Some reference, which I'm happy to share with you guys. In my first slide, I have my contact information. I'll be happy to post that at the end. Do you guys have any questions?
Thank you, Dr. Argon. It was a very good webinar. It seems we do have a question from the student Wilkin Quintana, and she asks, how long can you live with Alzheimer's?
How long can you live with Alzheimer's?
Yes.
That depends very much on the stage that it is diagnosed in. If you're just for discussion purposes, if you're diagnosed in a later stage and you're about 75 years of age, the life expectancy is about 5 to 10 years. On the milder stages, it also is very dependent on the other risk factors that are present, if you have any other comorbidities. But the earlier you can detect it, the life expectancy and the quality of life might be better, but you're looking about 10 to 15 years from the moment that is diagnosed.
Okay. Perfect. And
on the early stages, I'm sorry, I want to clarify that on the early stages.
Okay. All right. No problem. And it seems that I don't think the students have any other questions, but I'm sure, you know, given that you shared your contact information, they may reach out to you in the future. Cool. Right. But great. Oh, wait. Oh, it seems we're getting some questions in just now.
Okay. Yeah.
So student Ruth Victoriano asks, you mentioned exercise. So what type of exercises would you recommend for an 80-year-old woman?
I always, there are different centers, of course, and we in the United States, we're privileged to having a lot of senior citizen centers where they're specialized, or they have specialized teams that will help the patient in their physical exercise. As much aerobic exercise as they can do would be best. If they're able to do, I think physical therapists would recommend aqua aerobics or water-based exercises, if they're able to tolerate them, would be better because it's no resistance, low impact. However, the respiratory function has to be monitored. But just walking is, if they're able to do that, walking is a very good exercise they can do around the house. It is not expensive. They can do it with the guidance of someone in the household. If they're not able to walk, just mild stretching where they can get their blood pumping. Of course, you don't want an elderly patient to be just sitting in bed. The risks of decubital ulcers is high, and that can lead to infection and unfortunately death. So walking will help. Again, this is very dependent on the patient's physical state, not just cognitive state. The recommendation for physical exercise, aerobic exercise, lies more on the mild, moderate stages, whereas on the latter stages, you want to have some mobility there. But that's more from a vascular standpoint than it is a cognitive benefit to it.
All right, we have one more question from Alejandra Guerrero. She asks, from an ethical standpoint, how do you treat an Alzheimer's patient who may not have any family?
That is a great question. I'm glad you brought that up, because I did not put in a slide about ethics, and that's mostly just because of the complexity of it. In the United States, which is where I'm practicing, and that's where I can speak. I trained in Mexico, but I'm not too familiar with the legal statutes for that. In the United States, someone that has Alzheimer's disease or advanced versions of dementia, you can ask the state for a guardianship, and the state will take them as their word and provide informed consent. And on some occasions in some cities, you do have resources for individuals that have no insurance. Of course, Medicare will kick in, state-funded facilities will take care of the patients. But it's usually you make an argument, you make an evaluation, and take it to court. The court will appoint a guardianship. As psychiatrists, we are tasked with guardianship evaluations more often than I would like to be. But it's a good possibility. If they have no family, you reach out to the court, the court will take a guardianship, and the court-appointed guardian will help. If you watch the movie I Care a Lot, fortunately, that is something that doesn't happen, at least too often to my knowledge, but there are bad people everywhere. But the process is that someone establishes that they cannot take care of themselves, they have no family, you can ask the court to step in and help you.
Okay. Okay, the next question from Diana Feliciano, she asks, if a patient cannot do physical activity and has been diagnosed a long time ago, has all the medications signed but keeps getting worse, what would be the approach to the case?
That, I guess, alludes to that slide where we need to have a conversation with the family. The best treatment approach, and this is the interdisciplinary care model, you want to start from the beginning to try and incorporate all these things. Social work, psychiatrist, neurologist, the primary care provider for this patient, but most importantly, the family members. So when the diagnosis has been established, If it was my patient, I was the one to establish it. I always make it a point of talking to my patients and their relatives about the expected course of illness. It is important to know what to expect. I cannot give them an accurate time frame because everyone's different, right? But knowing that memory will continue to decline, their functions will continue to decline, they will be more dependent on the family, gives them an opportunity to start preparing. Now, depending on where you live, the insurance that you have, resources available in your community, families can start planning on getting assistance at home or thinking about placing the patient in a locked memory unit if the disorder is so severe. I hope that answered the question.
I believe so. I mean, she did have a follow-up, but I'm assuming at that point it wouldn't be beneficial to change the treatment option, right?
Sometimes we do symptomatic treatment, but again, it's a very very crucial and very, very careful risk benefit approach, because if the patient becomes more agitated and that's the only thing you're trying to address, sure, you can adjust the medications, but you're going after those symptoms. You're not going after the disorder itself. You're not going to restore cognitive ability. So I think it's a very important point to make with the patient's family that we're not going to fix them. We're not going to cure them, but we might help them be a little bit more calm. We might help them be a little bit more at ease at home, without, of course, sedating them so that they cannot participate at all, because that's, again, quality of life is what we're aiming for.
So once you get to a stage where, you know, medication is not going to be effective, you're just worried more about improving the quality of life instead of actually curing the disease, because there's kind of no, you can't really turn back the clock in a sense.
Right, exactly. Yeah, that patient has been unfortunately turned. And again, we don't know if Adulhelm is going to change that for us in the future. I sure hope it does. But as of now, as a part of clinical guidelines, changing the medications, we, as you saw, we only have a handful. So you can only change cholinesterase inhibitors from one to another that does the exact same thing. You can add them in combinations. But odds are, in advanced stages, you've already tried these combos, and you're going for more symptomatic management of agitation, sleep. Anorexia is something very important that we also try to address sometimes with medications to stimulate appetite, but to get symptomatic treatment.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, and I think that's all the questions. I have many questions, you know, still. Personally, I enjoy these type of topics a lot, you know, but right. I'm sure we can talk more in the future,
yeah, maybe
on a one-on-one basis. But again, thank you so much, Dr. Aragon, for this webinar. I thought it was very good, and I hope the students enjoyed it.
Sure,
you know, and thank you for joining us. Students, you know, thank you for coming. You know, please feel free to answer the survey that you get at the end of the webinar, you know, and then tomorrow you should be receiving an email with a copy of the recording, just if you want to rewatch and just kind of relearn some things. Also, you'll be receiving kind of a diploma that you can download for attending the webinar. All right. And overall, thank you very much, Dr. Aragon.
Hey, thank you very much for having me. I appreciate the opportunity.
No, please. It's our pleasure. It's an honor to have you, you know, and overall, thank you so much for the topic. I thought it was very great.
Thank you. And students, if you want to reach out, my contact information is on the screen. Feel free to shoot me an email at any point. Any questions, follow-up, concerns, just feel free to curbside.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much, Dr. Aragon. You have a good day.
You as well. Take care.
All right.
Bye.